Betsy, Michael. Good afternoon, everyone. We're going to get started with our next panel. So I hope you will join me and take your seats. Good afternoon. I'm Gloria Castillo. I am the director of We Rise Together for an Equitable and Just Recovery. And it is absolutely my pleasure to bring to you the final panel of this afternoon, and I think you're going to really enjoy our three panelists. So let me begin. I just introduced myself, but I just want to tell you that this subject matter, advancing diverse suppliers, is something that is so important to me, and it should be important to all of you, because Chicago is a city with immense talent, incredible opportunities for diverse suppliers, and they are an economic engine for this city. So we have an opportunity to hear from some folks who are helping us drive that economic engine in a really important way. What we know is that institutional supplier diversity programs, corporate programs that advance diverse suppliers are incredibly important and instrumental in helping minority businesses and women-owned businesses achieve scale. So we really want to learn today about the successful models that are being implemented and the innovative programs that help move the needle in supporting diverse suppliers and professional service firms. Our esteemed panel will share their winning strategies with us. And so let me introduce Cliff Goins, COO of Scale Up at Amazon, Betsy Ziegler, CEO of 1871, and Michael Fassnacht, CEO of World Business Chicago. So I'm going to start, I kind of teed you up here a little bit, so you asked me for a softball, I'm going to go with it. Cliff, let's talk a little bit about why supplier diversity programs, business diversity programs, are important at Amazon.
Sure. Well, you really kind of hit the nail on the head talking about it being an economic engine. I'm sure many of you are familiar with McKinsey's research. They've gone real deep in the last couple of years, and we understand that there's upwards of a $4 trillion per annum economic potential that's being left on the table because we're not actually building black and brown communities. And so we think supplier diversity is just one of the vectors where you can start to chip away at that. What we found with our research as we started to go deep into supplier diversity is that there's about a $300 billion gap between what companies and large government organizations say they want to spend with diverse suppliers and what they're actually spending with diverse suppliers. And so we're putting together some mechanisms to try to lean into that number.
Wonderful. Betsy, for you, thinking about 1871 in the tech sphere, why is it important?
Yeah, so I'll talk in general first and then maybe about 1871. So on the theme of economic development, if you look back over the last three decades, all 40 million net new jobs came from small businesses. So if the startup engine is broken, the job creation engine is broken. And so from my perspective, we need as many people building new businesses in the neighborhoods that they live in as possible. And when I think about the importance of supplier diversity, for me, that's all about innovation. Right, if I have a number of organizations that I'm working with to supply what my business needs to grow and scale, I'm going to get much better ideas and much more exposure. And then every dollar that we can spend with a diverse founder that might be building in a diverse community benefits that community even more.
Thank you. And Michael, from the perspective of World Business Chicago.
So our insight always is that we believe our talent is equally distributed across all 77 neighborhoods, but economic opportunities are not. So then we think, what are the strategies to address that? And we have three. One is what we call economic placemaking, like a Discover call center at Chatham, through Crosper Shield Investments. So really bringing the business into some of our neighborhoods in the South and West Side. Second, hiring. So make sure, you know, we're changing the HR regulations. Who do we hire? How do you think about that? Looking at unusual places maybe to hire more, especially black and brown talent. And then third is supply diversity. And I call this capacity building, because we really have to build capacity of our businesses. They don't right now have the scale, but we have to help them. How can they get better access to capital? I know BMO is focusing a lot on that. How can we get access to technology? How can we get access to customers? So we do a lot of things and all these things to enabling ultimately to big capacity building in our black and brown owned businesses across Chicago.
Thank you, Michael. I'm going to stay with you for a second, because World Business Chicago and Mayor Lightfoot recently hosted a very successful venture summit, and there was a lot of discussion about business diversity. So what we want to know is, what did you learn in that process of bringing so many businesses together? And what is the city really doing kind of on a tactical level to support diverse businesses?
So when we think about what is our superpower at World Business Chicago, we are like a connector that brings four different constituent groups together that normally don't talk as much. Corporations, the startup ecosystem with people like Betsy and her organization, capital, venture capital and private equity capital, and corporate capital, and academia. Because these four groups quite often don't talk, and they need more forums to talk, and we believe we have to go very deep on industry sectors. We have five sectors we're believing in. We will grow in Chicagoland more than other regions, which is logistics, life sciences, manufacturing, fintech, and then food and ag. And so we do venture summits where we bring these four groups together on these sectors, and we did logistics. And then when we bring these people together, we want to make sure very intentionally, who do you highlight? Which town do you highlight? Which businesses? And like when we did the Food and Ag Venture Summit, 65% of companies we highlight are either black and brown owned or female owned. Logistics is a little bit less diverse, so we're a little bit more challenged, with roughly 50%. So we're very intentionally, because ultimately, when you give them spotlights, love, attention, and these things, and we knew a lot of deals happened based on this Venture Summit. So that's what we will do intentionally. But I believe more and more we have to be very sector specific in bringing these four groups together, especially academia. We have an unbelievable university system here, and sometimes too often we leave them outside instead of bringing them in, because we have a lot of as well black and brown professors who are entrepreneurial academics who we want to highlight more and bring into our ecosystem.
That's terrific. And Betsy, let's kind of go deep into 1871, because you are really an innovation hub that's important to Chicago, and I think one of the first in the country of its style. You have resources, you have kind of the attention of the business community in a really important way, lots of partners. At 1871, how are you thinking about integrating small businesses into one of the most important sectors in our country, the innovation tech center? Sector of our country. So tell us a lot, you know, go deep with 1871.
Deep. All right. How many of you have heard of 1871? All right. And of those, how many have been to 1871? All right, pretty good. So 1871 has changed quite a bit over the last, we've been around for 10 years, we've changed quite a bit. We now cover the full maturity curve of a business, and so we've got people that come with just an idea and trying to figure out if that idea can turn into something that customers will value and pay money for. Then we've got growth stage companies. We've got early stage idea to launch the business. We've got growth stage companies that have customers and are scaling. And then we've got big corporate. And so we're doing more and more to bring all of those groups together under different themes. We worked with World Business Chicago. We did a supply chain industry innovation program that the capstone of which was the WBC Logistics Summit. We do a program with BMO Harris Bank on women fintech leaders, right? There's a number of things we're doing to try to connect the really big to the up and coming. And then those growth companies. Just to give you some stats, you told me to go deep, so I'm going to go deep. When you look at the early stage companies that have started at 1871 over the last decade, they've created 15,000 jobs in the city of Chicago. I think that's a pretty big number. I don't know. We estimate that as about $1 billion of annual salary impact, with sort of estimating about $70,000 a job. That's an estimate. I don't know if that's right or wrong, but it's sort of a fair estimate. They raised $3.5 billion of capital. So for me, it's less about how much money they've raised and more about the potential of those companies to create even more opportunities for people in the Chicagoland area. 23%, our goal is to mirror the city of Chicago in terms of the demographics of our founders. 23% of our founders right now are Black, 10% are Latin, 29% are female. Our goal is 30% Black minimum, 20% Latin minimum, and, well, I don't know if we'll get to 50%. We're shooting for 35 on the female front. When I think about our opportunity to influence this conversation about supplier diversity, there's a little that I can do inside my own budget. So my own budget, we're small. We don't seem small, but we are. We're small budget. I have only about 10% of my budget is variable cost. And about a third of that has the potential to be spent on a whole variety of different suppliers. So we've got lists. I'm doing a talk tonight with the founder of Sprinkles Cupcakes. And the people that are, you're welcome to come on over. Actually, there might be events here, so don't leave your event for it. But we've got a list of diverse suppliers to provide food, drinks, floral, like all of those kinds of things. And so we don't do anything that isn't off that list. When we have people that rent our space for events, we encourage them to use those lists to drive who supports their events. When we support big corporates, right, we're constantly putting in front of them diverse companies that might be tech companies that they might partner with or become a customer of or make a strategic investment in. So there's a whole number, like our influence is way bigger than our spend. And so I have to constantly balance, are we making the right decisions inside of the things that I can actually drive change in inside my own budget? And then how am I trying to activate change with the other people that we work with by leveraging that whole system of companies from I have an idea to, you know, I'm a big scaling company.
Great.
That was deep?
Yeah, it was deep. Yeah, we're going to come back, too.
Okay.
Cliff. A few of us have, you know, kind of Amazon accounts and
boxes.
You know, during
lots of boxes.
During the pandemic, yeah, we tended to get lots of boxes.
I have the same problem in my house.
Yeah, so good. I have a few of those boxes. In fact, I got a notice today that I got a delivery. But Amazon has been really influential in entrepreneurship across the country, but particularly for businesses of color. And so I'd like for you to talk to us about Amazon's role in supporting entrepreneurs and advancing diverse suppliers, not only for the kind of a retail products that we think about normally, but you have a broad spectrum across sectors. So how does Amazon interact with diverse suppliers?
Yeah, I mean, it's a big question, right? We're the second largest company in the States, right? And we touch a lot of different businesses. I was talking with folks earlier, and they're like, oh yeah, I forgot you guys own Zappos. And so we own a lot of different businesses. I think the ethos of Amazon is about scaling, and it's about entrepreneurship. Most folks obviously think about the dot-com side. That's why we can have a big conversation about boxes showing up at our houses. But that whole ecosystem, about 50, 60% of it is actually entrepreneurs selling through Amazon. And then if you look on the other side of the business, you have our AWS business. We have a whole AWS marketplace that is actually built for entrepreneurs who are mostly tech entrepreneurs. And so that's in our ethos. And so we have a lot of different initiatives going on across Amazon around supplier diversity. I'll talk a little bit about the one that that I'm involved with. It's called Scale Up, and coming off of George Floyd, you know, a lot of people obviously got motivated. And one of the questions we asked was like, well, how do we actually take this machine that's known for spurring entrepreneurship, and how do we leverage that at the time for Black-owned businesses? And we started with this hypothesis like, hey, we actually, sure, we need more black-owned businesses, but we actually need more large black-owned businesses. And so we drew a stake in the sand around $100 million and started doing some research. And then for us, what we found was there were less than 100 black-owned businesses doing $100 million or more in the States. I've had a couple of people, Jim Lowry, arguing with me about it the other week, but it's not a big number. So even if it's not 100, so that, because that's less than 1% of $100 million businesses, okay? And so we started down this path of like, how do you actually take businesses that are doing 2, 5, 10, 20 and get them on a path to $100 million? And so we incubated a concept. We were in an incubator at Amazon. We incubated a concept over the last 12 months. And where we landed as we started working with customers and talking to companies, talking to the various, we have 36 different procurement departments in Amazon that we know of. And it became very clear that one of the vectors is in supplier diversity. And so we've been working a lot, not only with Amazon supplier diversity, but other big corporations you would know, and some government entities, to really try to bring resources around these businesses to help them grow. We look at it three ways. We talk about champions, which are not mentors, but these are people who are actually advocates, not just advisors, people who can really open up doors. We talk about capital, which is what we talked a lot about today, and that's the full capital stack. How do you connect entrepreneurs with the right capital at the right time? And you know, the big C is customers. So how do you take someone who's maybe doing a little bit with Amazon and connect them to other corporate customers so that they actually have a diverse business and become you know, less risky for those who are investing in them? And so we have a hypothesis. We incubated it for the last year. We're moving into a next phase of testing out how it can work next year. So we've tested some stuff manually. We've prototyped some technology to kind of help do it. And you know, it's an exciting project, and I'm happy that Amazon is backing it for now. Yeah, it's crazy. That's a crazy. It's a crazy set.
You know, it's interesting. And Michael, when I think about companies like Amazon who put a big stake in Chicago, and part of what World Business Chicago does is represent Chicago to companies around the world as a great place to do business. When you're talking with companies, what are they thinking about in terms of diverse suppliers and the value of strong, diverse suppliers in Chicago and growing the scale of them? And do they talk with you about their supplier diversity programs and how important it is for their own success? So, you know, it's interactive. It's both their success and it's the success of the city that they make an investment in.
It's a very good question. I mean, I spend a lot of time, because I have like 105 CEOs on my board of the last company, so a lot of conversations. And I always like to talk about the intersection of like historical truth and business imperative. Hmm. And some of the most toughest discussion was historical truth. I think me in Chicago, and you know, you might think I have an accent, so I probably haven't been growing up here. But sometimes I can see it's like we have not embraced, a lot of our business leaders, the historical truth that it is not by accident where we are today. The disenfranchised neighborhood in Southwest is not an accident. This was policy. There were decisions by the business elite, by city government, where we ended up. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of, you know, a lot of businesses profited from that. Mm-hmm. And I think that I tell the mayor, we have a lot of work to do in the city to drive with historical truth. I think only if you embrace it and understand that, you can really move forward. Mm-hmm. So I think always when I talk with CEOs, you have to understand the history of the city, where we are, to understand what you can serve. So this is one discussion, which is sometimes very painful. The second discussion is business imperative. We all know, research has shown over and over, if you have a diverse workforce and diverse ecosystem, you are a higher performing company. Mm-hmm. And this will be more important in 1 year, in 5 years, in 10 years. So if you want to be an amazing, global, great company, you have to have a diverse workforce across all dimensions of diversity, and you need a diverse ecosystem. And when we talk with companies to attract here, the number one advantage Chicago is our diversity. So they said, if you want to, why did Google come here now, the largest corporate expansion? Because they saw the diverse talent pool. Mm-hmm. Because I always, you know, Chicago is a fascinating city. You know, I lived there for 20 years. Because on our best day, we are the most diverse city in the world, with all its beautiful. Worst day, with the most segregated city in the world too. And we have to, at least when I talk with companies, I focus on diversity, and the nice thing or the encouraging thing is companies look at that, understand that more and more, and make them what we call pro-Chicago decisions, because they understand if they manage it correctly, they can grow here more, be more successful, while understanding the history of our city, of our country.
And that's, you know, I think that's the opportunity. And it's the opportunity for us to really take advantage of the talent here. And we have incredible entrepreneurial talent here. I've, you know, been a long advocate. But one of the challenges for Black and Latinx businesses that I've experienced is the opportunity to grow. So it's wonderful to have access to technical assistance. It's very important to have access to capital. It is paramount to have access to revenue. That's it. That's what it comes down to. Betsy, what do you see as the barriers in the tech industry for tech entrepreneurs of color? Because we, you know, we don't see them growing as rapidly as we would like to, and it's a very competitive business. So what do you see as the barriers, and where can we go to actually create solutions to meet those challenges?
So Michael made the comment a few minutes ago that talent is equally distributed, but access is not. The same is true with entrepreneurial talent and entrepreneurial aspiration. It's equally distributed, but not. But access to resources, access to customers, access to financing is not. If you talk, and I really focus on tech founders versus a small business owner who opens a hair salon or a landscaping business or a corner store, right? All my attention is really on the tech founders. If you look at people that are early builders, like, you know, in that kind of, I'm building out the first version of my product or service, the average white founder starts with $18,000 in their pocket. Anyone have a guess of what the average black founder starts with? How much? Five what?
$5.
Somebody else? Yeah, so the number is 500. So that's a 37x gap. And that is not about going to angel investors or going to venture capitalists. That is literally, I have money in the bank, I want to start. And so then what we're trying to say is, okay, do we have a talent problem? No. There are extraordinary black and brown founders that are solving really important problems, but they can't afford to focus on them full time because they don't have money to fund their life. And so are there things that we can do to, which is not where venture capitalists play, right? When venture capitalists don't invest when you have an idea, right, that you have to be further down the path. And so are there things that we can do to get the very top black and brown founders in Chicago access to, right now the number we're focused on is $150,000, so they can fund their life for a year while they really focus on building their business. With all of the supported, you know, all the support from 1871, or if they're building in life sciences with Matter, or hardware product with MHub, et cetera, which are organizations that if you don't know, you should know. So, number one is there's this amazing talent that we want, by the way, to be building in the neighborhood they live in. We're through COVID, right? Like, you don't have to be in the merchandise mart to get access to us. We've got founders all over the world now. So I don't care if you're in Englewood or Bronzeville or Westridge or wherever you are, you can have access to 1871 in person or virtually. But we want you to build where you live. So our first thing is, can we arm the very best with enough money so they can focus on their business full time? And if they can focus on their business full time, then we'll walk them into any customer that they want. I spend a lot of hours every week, Michael does too, introducing people to other people. I wake up early Saturday morning and I do one-on-ones on Fridays, and so I have my to-do list that goes into Saturday morning, and it's, you know, introduce Michael to so-and-so and Cliff to so-and-so and da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And that's what we do. And so you made the comment about customers. I totally agree, but I need them to get enough. I need the business to be far enough along such that they can perform in front of those customers and actually get the contract that then they can scale. And for the companies that are a little further along, our whole focus is cash and contracts.
Which makes great sense. And Cliff, Amazon has one of the largest tech platforms anywhere. I didn't mean to turn this into a complete tech conversation, but it's an important part.
Every company's a tech company.
Every company's a tech company. But I think one of the things that we see in tech is innovation. So how do we, you know, what have you seen in terms of partnerships coming to you, pitches coming to you, where they've brought innovation, different ways to grow their business in partnership with Amazon? You know, that was not in the list of questions, but it was my personal interest. I thought, wow, this is kind of fascinating.
I'll give a real life example. So I told you all, we ran an experiment over the last year. We worked with a certain number of black-owned businesses. And one of those businesses had kind of started to do some business with Amazon, but they actually are in the diverse supplier certification business. And so they built a technology that actually completely streamlines the process. And so Amazon and actually some other corporations have now kind of taken their platform and are using it, especially for smaller suppliers, to get them certified so that whatever spend that companies do with them actually counts towards their diverse number. And so that's a situation where you have a smaller black entrepreneur who was like, hey, this certification process, it takes too long. And it's expensive if you're a small business, so how can I kind of disrupt that? And they brought that not only to Amazon, but to other corporations. And so that's a great example of, that's why you need more diverse thinking and even smaller, nimble companies that can kind of think about, come at the problem differently.
Which, we've got a couple of minutes left, and I really appreciate the kind of thinking about opportunity. If we were going to, like kind of a quick round robin, if we were going to say to entrepreneurs in the audience, over the next 3 years, you're going to give it your all, where would you put your focus so that you could grow a business that interacts with corporate clients, right? Because it takes planning to do business with corporate clients. What would you advise a business to do to prepare themselves to do a great pitch to a corporate client? Michael, I'm going to start with you and come on down.
I believe you have to show up. You have to go to events. You have to connection. You have to show up every single day. And I think the more you show up, the more you find your voice, the more you find your pitch. The great thing is about Chicago, I think, you know, people are welcoming. They want to help. They want to be engaged. And my advice is, independent which sector, show up. Don't be shy to ask. I mean, I think it's an amazing country, an amazing city. People want to help, but you have to show up and you have to ask.
I like that, Betsy.
I think you have to be solving a problem they care about.
That's where I was going.
Sorry.
No, I got you. I'm a plus
and
one.
So there's a lot of people that show up and I have this idea, I'm deeply passionate about this idea, and then they go through a process to determine, does anybody else care about that idea, or care about the solution that you're bringing to that idea? And that's a really rigorous customer discovery process. And you know, enterprise companies are not, if you're not actually solving their problem or can't talk their talk, you're not gonna make it.
Yeah, I want to plus one that. That was my talk. I mean, at the end of the day, it's about customers, but it's about solving actual customer needs. So you can have the greatest idea, but if you haven't battle tested it with customers, it doesn't matter. I mean, we had an idea, but we spent the last year with customers. And that's why we believe, okay, we're going to do a next phase of this, and you know what we're going to do? We're going to spend it with customers, but we have a better idea of what we need to do. You don't do that, you're going to be dead in the water. So,
okay, we've got it.
We
show up,
did it.
Know your customer, have the solutions ready. That's what we're going to do to grow our businesses. And so with that, I want to thank this panel. Please help me thank this fabulous panel. And I will ask our host, Eric Smith, to come back up. to begin the fireside chat. I'm really excited with Damon John. Thank you.